morning.
Morning.
So this is episode 2 of Worshipping in Psalms, using this book I said I was using last time from the LICC, London Institute of Contemporary Christianity. So we're worshipping, looking at the Psalms. So last time we looked at Psalm 145, about worshipping because of who God is, not because of how we feel. So today we're looking at Psalm 34, entitled Worshipping in All of Life. We heard verses 1 to 14. So the background to this psalm is from 1 Samuel chapter 21. David is working for Saul, who is the king, and he's doing well. God is with him. Saul's jealous because he knows that David will be king one day. So Saul tries to kill David. David runs away, obviously, and he runs to the Philistine city of Gath. He realizes that he's vulnerable there because he's in an enemy city and the Philistines don't like the Israelites. So he pretends to be mad and the king throws him out and he survives. David attributes his escape to God. Not his own clever idea, not his acting skills, not the king's gullibility. He says it's God who has saved him. And he writes Psalm 34 in response to that. So, as we look at the psalm today, I want you to keep those two questions in your mind. Like we talked about them last time, but here they are again. What can we learn from David's worship of the one true God that will enrich our worship? And the second question, how does this affect my front line? How do I live this out in all the places that I go, the people that make up my week? How does it affect what I do, how I behave, how I am? And remember that worship is so much more than singing songs. It's about how we live our life in response to who God is. So I've picked three things out of this psalm. There might be other things that strike you as you hear the words again, as you're listening to what I say. God might have something completely different to say to you. That's fine. But I've picked out three things that struck me. The first is, this psalm talks to me about passionate worship. Verse 1 said, I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. David's worship comes from his personal experience of God in particular, specific situations. It flows out of who he's experienced God to be. And if this experience leads him to praise God passionately, I will extol the Lord at all times, he says. His praise will always be on my lips. This isn't a half-hearted response. This isn't a muttered thank you, like when your child's been given a present and you nudge them and say, have you said thank you? And they say, thank you. It's not that. It's not some muttered, well, I'll just say it quick and get it over with response. It's not a, well, I'm really grateful today, but I've probably forgotten about it by tomorrow response either. This is a passionate, this is an all the time, this is part of who he is. His praise will always be on my lips, David says. My Bible readings at the moment are also in 1 Samuel, including this passage that I said that the psalm is based on. It's all about the contrast between Saul as king and David, and how in the situations they face, David asks God what he should do, and then he does it, mostly. But he asks God, and then he does it. Saul gets on with doing what he wants to do. Doesn't really consult God, except at some particular times when he feels utterly desperate. The contrast between them is really marked. Someone who asks God first, someone who just breezes in. Reading this psalm and reading how David was living suggests to me that praising God for David was a natural, passionate and constant part of his life. That's quite a challenge, isn't it? Quite a challenge to live like that with God's praise always on your lips. I think it's good to notice that passionate doesn't necessarily mean loud. You know, some people are naturally loud, exuberant people, and they live their lives and they sing their songs, and the way they play out with people is loud and exuberant. That's great if that's how they are. But passionate can also be quiet. It can be that steely determination. It can be the core inside, not always shown in big, loud, demonstrative gestures. Just thought that was worth saying. But then I was thinking as well about other examples of passionate worship. I thought about Noah, who God called to build a boat somewhere where there was no rain in the middle of the desert. He stuck with it, he got on with it, he did his job, and he saw it through, despite, I can only imagine what everybody else around him was saying. His worship was doing what God had asked him to do, despite what everybody else thought. What about Ruth? Ruth, who got married and then her husband died, and she felt called to follow her mother-in-law away from all her family and friends, to go back to where her mother-in-law was from and start a new life in a new with a new people. That's worship, isn't it? Not that we should all do that, though I get on very well with my mother-in-law who is here this morning. We're not all called to do that. That's not the point, is it? The point is Ruth did what God asked her to do. She lived out her life. That was her worship. What about Daniel and his friends, who'd been taken into exile into a foreign land where they worshipped other gods, and there was huge pressure from the king downwards to worship the gods of the land they lived in? Daniel and his friends didn't do that. They lived their life with God, despite the cost to them. That to me looks like passionate worship. What about Paul in the New Testament? Went from persecuting Christians, but after he met God and he worshipped who Jesus was, he then travelled around teaching, encouraging people in all sorts of places, and he continued to worship God and put God first, even in prison. That's passionate worship, isn't it? Perhaps you don't face any of those situations. Maybe you've got your own ways of living this out. I've been reading this week about the MAFTI, the Mission Aviation Fellowship. That's another charity we support that have these fabulous little aeroplanes that get into all sorts of places, remote places that nobody else can get to. And they go to great lengths to make runways so these planes can land. They fly in tricky conditions. They go to places that no one else can get to. That's passionate worship, isn't it? Not just stopping because it seems a bit tricky, but finding God's way through. And what about the persecuted Christians across the world? Hope we're still all praying for our countries. Those Christians who endure abuse, rejection, death, grief, being thrown out of their jobs, being ostracised by their families, but still choose to worship Jesus. Passionate worship, isn't it? In all sorts of different ways. I feel it's really easy to get blasé about worshipping God, to become over-familiar, perhaps, to take him for granted, to get used to the astonishing way that he is and the things that he does, for it to become ordinary because we're so familiar with it. It's easy, perhaps, to go through the motions of worship with one eye on God, but another eye on how people around us are reacting to what we're doing. It's so easy that we just get used to it, that we limit him, that we water it down a bit. That's not what David encourages us to do. I will extol you at all times. Your praise will always be on my lips. That's not half-hearted, that's passionate. And in the words of one of the great, fabulous traditional hymns, "When I survey the wondrous cross," the last line, "Love so amazing, so divine, demands my life, my soul, my all." David's example through this psalm challenges us to worship God passionately through how we live at all times in all the situations we face. That's the first thing. The second thing I've labelled shared worship. David's response to God is to worship who God is, himself. He's got personal worship of this is God. But it doesn't stop there. Verses 2 and 3 said, "I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together." David's experience is encouraging other people to worship him as well. We don't know if these people he's encouraging are people that were involved in the situation with him, whether they're people he told about it afterwards. We don't know their situation. But we know that he is encouraging others to praise because what he has experienced of God. His experience has given them a glimpse of God with him and also given them hope for the situation that they're in. Look what God has done for me. This is who God is. This is who God is for you as well. So it's not just, this praise and worship is not just for those who are full of joy already. It said, let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Let those who are struggling, let those who are in difficult times, let those who've got things going on that are tricky and scary and hard to face, let them hear who God is and rejoice. They're encouraged to rejoice, to glorify God, and to exalt his name. They're not obvious reactions in difficult times, are they? I think for us it tells us that what we see of God is good news for us and affects how we are. But it's also good news for other people, especially perhaps those who are struggling and suffering. That's why David's encouraging church news at the moment. It's great to hear good things going on and celebrate with other people. It's why we do encourage testimony. We're thrilled when people have something of God that they will share with other people. When Jamie shared his experience a couple of weeks ago, we had a shared rejoicing in God's goodness to Jamie. But I know that his experience gave hope to someone else in the same situation. For many years, I did mission weekends, and a scary part of that was giving a testimony. But we were given very clear guidance on how to do it. It was never about us. It was always about who God is and what he's doing in us and through us. The focus had to be God. At the end of what we'd said, people should be left praising God, not thinking we were great. In the LICC notes, it says, God's specific intervention at a particular time deepens trust in him for other challenges. As we remember what God has done, it gives us confidence for the future. Let me just read to you. I was thinking I didn't need the Bible, but I realise I do. So let me just read to you verses 4 to 7, just to show this is some of what David is saying God does. This poor man called, and the Lord heard. Oh, sorry, verse 4. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers him. Aren't they fabulous promises to share with people in tricky times? Fabulous things that we can pass on that give hope and courage and joy. I encourage you this week to spend some time thinking what God has been doing in your life. Maybe in the past, maybe recently. Think of particular examples where you have seen God at work, what you experienced about him, what you learned, how that has changed you and affected how you live. Then ask God to give you opportunities to share those with other people, so the afflicted that you know can hear and rejoice. Have a think. See what God comes up with. And maybe you'll have the privilege of sharing joy with somebody else who needs to hear it. David's words encourage us to share our experiences so God can bless others through us. Shared worship. The final thing that really struck me is about fearful worship. Picks up a little bit, I think, on what Mike was saying at the beginning about blasphemy and how important it is to speak up and stand up against it. Verse 9 said, fear the Lord, you his holy people. So fear, in this context, isn't about being scared. It's not that terror, fear. The Life Application Bible explains it as to show deep respect and honour to God, to have genuine worship and a humble attitude. And the NIV Study Bible said it's to honour God and order our lives in accordance with his will because of our reverence for him. It's about awe and reverence and respect and recognising who God is. It's not about being fearful. Lots of references to this in the Bible and other places. So Proverbs 9, you ready, Graham? Proverbs 9, verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Proverbs 14, verse 27. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life. Deuteronomy 6, verse 13. Moses says, fear the Lord your God, serve him only, and take your oaths in his name. Revelation 14, in one of John's visions, an angel says, fear God and give him glory. Fear of the Lord is about awe and wonder, about respect for who he is recognizing that he is holy and perfect. He is Almighty God. He is so much more than a better version of us. And then it's about changing our behavior because we recognize who he is. My pod at the moment is looking at Ezekiel. Definitely challenging, definitely thought-provoking. What comes through strongly is that God is an awe-inspiring God to be worshipped. Not an equal with the gods, the idols of the other cultures around. Not a pick any one of these, it doesn't matter which one. Pick the one you fancy. He's saying that he is the one almighty or powerful God. Not a cute, warm, cuddly God, but a God of integrity and justice who takes it seriously when people mock him. A God to be treated with awe and respect. A God whose words are to be taken seriously and who can be trusted to keep his word and do what he says. This is a God to be revered and honoured. Do you think it's easy for us to water God down so he fits into our lives? To focus on that he's always ready if we choose to have time to talk to him. That he's to remember that he's always forgiving whatever we've done. He is those things. He is. But we need to fear the Lord, to have the respect, recognise that he's in charge, not us. Recognise he's not at our beck and call. That's a really important cornerstone for our worship. Being a Christian is an important business that needs to come first, or not at all. It needs to be the impetus for all we do and all we are because of who he is. Think over the centuries the church has swung between very formal worship, perhaps sometimes legalistic, and very informal worship, perhaps a bit too casual. Do you remember the days of Sunday best, where you dressed up for church? Perhaps you had your one smartest outfit that you only wore on a Sunday and never else, never any other time. It's not quite like that today, is it? I can remember 25 years ago, I was in Liverpool, and I was involved in a joint service at the Catholic Cathedral. I can't remember how this came to be my job, but my job was to stand on the door at the Catholic Cathedral as all these young people and adults piled in, and to everybody wearing a hat, I had to say, please take your hat off, you're going into a place of worship. That was my contribution to the whole act of worship. This isn't a comment on whether you should be wearing a hat in church or not, it's really not. But it was interesting that that was my role. It was seen as respect, that the way we dressed was part of our worship. Fearing the Lord is not about our outward appearances. Although there is nothing wrong with expressing our heart for God through the way we dress. I'm not saying that at all. There's nothing wrong with that. But actually what God's interested in is our heart. Does it sound tricky? Well, don't worry. Verse 11, David says, I will teach you the fear of the Lord. In Deuteronomy 31, when Moses is giving instructions for the future, he says, assemble the people so they can listen to the law and learn to fear the Lord. So it's something that we need to learn to do, but something that we can learn. We don't have to be able to do it all at once. It's something we can learn. It might not come naturally, but it's something that can be learned. And when we're learning to do something, we don't always get it right straight away, do we? When I'm watching new videos, crocheting videos on YouTube, I have to watch it lots of times. And then I try a bit, and then I have to undo it, and then I try it again. And gradually, as I keep trying, it gets better. I keep comparing it to the video to check I've got it right, does it look like hers? The more I do it, the more natural it becomes. The more my hands can do it without thinking about it the same. I think it's the same about learning to fear God, to be fearful, to have the awe and respect. It's important to keep checking that we're not swinging too far one way or the other. We're not being too scared, like he's a God who's going to judge and that's all he'll do. And we're not swinging the other way and making him too light and easy and, oh well, anything goes, that's okay. That's why it's really crucial we keep reading and hearing the Bible, to discuss it, to think about it, to process it, to question it, to try and work out what it's saying to us. In the Bible, the fear of the Lord is often connected with obedience. Ecclesiastes 12 says, fear God and keep his commandments. The two things go together. In Psalm 128, it says, blessed are all who fear the Lord, who walk in his ways. Suggests it's two sides of the same coin. If we have respect and awe and wonder for God, then our lives and our behaviour and our words are affected by that. The end of the psalm that we heard, it gave us some practical actions to live out. I'm not going to go into them in great detail, I'm just going to tell you what they are and you can process them with God yourselves. Verse 13 said, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. That's about not bending the truth. It's about not exaggerating, not covering up, not making excuses. Probably includes judging, condemning, harsh words, gossip, gloating, all those things that we so easily at times slip into. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. Verse 14 said, turn from evil and do good. It's not enough to not do bad things. That's a good start. It's about actively doing good things. Not just not getting involved, but maybe taking a stand against it. Verse 14 also says, seek peace and pursue it. That takes effort and choice in those little situations that we face throughout the day. It's not just avoiding trouble, it's looking to make peace. David talks about passionate worship and shared worship and fearful worship. Do you know in my lessons, as you know, I go to lots of different schools. In my lessons, I have varying responses to my lessons. I have some children who want to watch, and they're taking it in. They're watching, but they're not actually joining in with what we're doing, but often we're quite pleased that they're watching. We have some children who do join in, but with as little effort as possible. You know, when you say we're going to do some stretching up, and they're like this. And they hardly move, but they kind of are, but they're not really, do you know? It's just the minimal they can get away without being singled out by me. And then I have some, thankfully, who join in enthusiastically, who just give their all to what we're doing and try their hardest. I can encourage them to join in. I can plan things I think will be suitable for them. I can try all my best strategies to get them to join in and want to try, but I can't make them. That's got to be their choice. It's the same for us. David encourages us to be passionate in our worship, to be sharing our worship so others can be blessed as well, and to be fearful, to approach him with the right attitude. Nobody can force us to do that. It's our own choice. So how are you joining in and living out your worship? Amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing a song about worship. We're going to sing When the Music Fades. And it says, sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When we've got it wrong, it's all about you. Going back to the heart of worship. We'll stand and sing When the Music Fades together.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come. Longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, have is yours, every single breath.
into my heart, into my heart.